This is Ocreep, a 12K macro pad that I made last year. I received a lot of feedback and suggestions during the last few months, and I decided it was time to make a new version. Not only that, but I will also try to make a bunch of external modules that snap together to form different layouts using this custom magnetic connector. Let's get to it.
Last version of the MacroPad was a great introductory project, and I recommend it if you're getting started with this kind of thing. However, for this version, there are a few improvements and some completely new features that I want to explore. So let's go over the changes and constraints first. It seems that some of you couldn't get the microcontroller I used before, the KB2040, and I understand that swapping the PCB footprint from the get-go isn't for everyone. So for this version, I'll use the Chow RP2040 from Seed Studio. It's small, cheap, and available pretty much everywhere. Plus, you get to choose from several drop-in replacements either from Seed Studio, Adafruit Qt Pyline, or others. The only thing to keep in mind is it only breaks out 11 GPIOs, which is definitely not enough for the way things were set up before. More on that later. In the last design, I made the switch plate and the top shell all in one part. Once you solder the switches to the board, it's pretty much closed off. You can't access the PCB from the other side without desoldering all of them. So this time we'll do two things. Add support for hot swap sockets and decouple the plate from the rest of the enclosure. The two encoders in the previous build required 6 pins. Given that we don't have a lot of GPIOs this time, we're going to have just one. But in exchange, we'll add the much asked for OLED screen. I will be using one of these widely available I2C modules to display layer changes and maybe other information. I got inspired to do the previous project after using the Creativity console by Monogram. A standout feature of the console is these connectors. They allow you to rearrange modules in various shapes and layouts tailoring to diverse workflows. I wondered for a while if I could pull off something similar for the MacroPad. And it was until I watched this video by Zach Friedman that reignited my interest in the idea. You should definitely check out this project, by the way, link down below. So the idea would be to be able to attach to the MacroPad all sorts of different peripherals, like encoders, buttons, and maybe potentiometers in various combinations. We will need some sort of grid system with a standard way to connect all the elements. Let me show you what I mean by all this, and let's get started on the prototype. I begin by making the size grid relative to the MacroPad size dimensions, where one grid unit equals the quarter of the MacroPad, assuming that the MacroPad will be a perfect square, of course. Each external module could be a multiple of these units, should have one upstream connection and many possible landings on all the remaining sides. All connectors are centered within the grid units. Now, for the connection itself, we will need power, ground, two pins for I2C, and maybe an extra pin to use as an interrupt, for a total of 5 pins, and of course the magnet arranged with the right polarity. I went to DigiKey and found these that you can get with magnets embedded already. There's only one slight problem. They cost over 10 bucks each and they come in pairs only, pins and made in parts. If I make 5 modules, for example, I will need 5 of them with pogo pins and around 30 landing pads. So maybe it's a good idea to design my own exactly like I want them. I will be making them out of small PCBs that will interlock with the main board. They'll have two locating features and will be soldered on both sides to the castellated pads on the edges, ensuring both mechanical and electrical connections. As for the upstream connector, I will use the exact same part as the landing and add these through-hole pogo pins to the center with the small shroud to keep them aligned. I will be soldering them the exact same way as the other ones. With the connectors more or less figured out, let's discuss how the MacroPad will communicate with the module. Each one of them should function as an I2C peripheral and the MacroPad should detect whenever there is an input event. I did some research first and fortunately I stumbled upon the Adafruit CISA framework, which can be configured to give a wide range of capabilities via I2C out of the box. In fact, they use it for this exact same reason as a near universal system for many of their I2C boards. This is awesome and it will save us a ton of work. So exactly like the breakouts, our modules will be running the CISA firmware on 80 tiny microcontrollers from Microchip. With all this in mind, I threw together some parts that are fairly similar to whatever I'll be using for the end product. Remember when I said that I don't have enough pins for the regular matrix setup? Well, for that reason, we'll use another technique to scan using shift registers. This only requires 3 pins from our main controller and it's already supported by KMK, the CircuitPython firmware running on Ocreep.
To test out the module idea, I connected the seesaw breakout board, I attached an encoder, potentiometer, and a button to cover the basic cases we'd want in these modules. Now, this extra wire represents the interrupt in the connector I mentioned earlier. I'm trying to avoid spamming the I2C bus constantly as much as possible, and try to leverage the seesaw configurable interrupt for digital inputs. It triggers when there's an interaction on the module side, and it will clear the flag after we read it from the MacroPad side. One thing to note here that I allocated only one pin for all the modules in our setup, so we can't pinpoint the exact source of the trigger. Any change in that pin state should prompt a scan to all the modules. I also added this I2C hot swap controller. I'm not sure how useful it would be, but since we plan on making removable modules, I thought it's a good idea to avoid messing up the controller if we disconnect mid-com. With these requirements laid out, and a basic prototype in hand, let's jump into Fusion 360 and get started on the PCBs. The first thing I did in this step is make these main sketches to derive from them the board outline and have an easy way to update and tweak the shapes down the line. Everything from the pogo pin height to the magnet thickness affect these dimensions, and I will be referencing these geometries throughout the entire design process. I got to work and laid out 5 boards in total. The main MacroPad core with 6 possible attachment points, a 4 rotary encoder module we'll call dials, one with 2 slide potentiometers we'll call faders, another one with 3 switches and an encoder we'll be calling combo. Okay. I know, right? Very original. Lastly, this funky one using a big ol' 60mm CNC encoder and 4 switches. I think this covers a good range of possibilities to start with, so I double checked all the files, including the 2 tiny connectors, and sent all of them to PCBWay. While waiting for the PCBs to show up, I can get started on the enclosures. Back in Fusion 360, I referenced the 3D PCBs produced in the previous step to design around them. The most crucial piece in my opinion is this section that surrounds the connectors. It needs to house the magnets and have precise tolerances where the connectors will interface. I did some tests and to see how thin the wall should be to get the magnets as close together as possible. I also had to determine the thickness for the shell to have the pogo pins sitting just right on the other part. Next, I dealt with the top part, including the switch plate, OLED screen opening, and the fasteners to secure the middle section to the main board. Then it was the bottom part to close off everything and also act as a diffuser for the RGB underglow. After figuring out the enclosure for the core MacroPad, I repeated the exact same process for all the modules, reusing parts, patterns, and sharing dimensions as much as possible to keep the overall design uniform.
With the enclosures completed, it's time for the fabrication, and for that I'll be using the UltraCraft Reflex 3D printing system by HeyGears, the sponsors of this video.
This was my first experience with resin printers, and I was happily surprised to be honest. HeyGears created a one-stop production platform to produce commercial-grade parts on a hobbyist level. The build quality of these machines is outstanding, and the closed-loop system ensures predictable success and offers a seamless 3D printing experience. I started by loading the resin bottle, which the printer detected automatically. It also monitors the resin level and will refill as needed on its own. How cool is that? The first batch for the top parts is done. I put them in the wash station with some isopropyl and sent the proper settings from the slicer directly. HeyGears came up with this cool dual tub system so that you don't have to fish the parts from the IPA. You simply open this valve into the empty container and collect your parts after the alcohol drains. Next, I removed the support and put the models in the cure station, which again received settings specially for the shape, material, and size of this model directly from the blueprint slicer. From then, it was rinse and repeat until I went through all the enclosure parts. Next, it's the translucent bottom parts. I repeated the same steps, but this time using the PAT resin, a strong and clear material with 88% transparency, which works great to diffuse the light for the RGB. The quality of these prints is amazing. Straight out the machine, the only post-processing I did was to sand down the support traces in few places where I needed a flat surface. I'm really happy with the outcome. And if you watched any of my previous projects, you would see how much time I spent just to get a decent surface finish. Now that we have all the parts printed, it's time to talk about the keycaps. In the previous version, I used these DSA style ones that I got online, but this time I modeled this. Heavily inspired from the grid set by RamaWorks, and I'm going to try and print them in custom colors using the UltraPrint Design PAM 10 mixable resins. Let me show you how that works. You get this swatch of colors that you reference in a table to get exact mixing ratios by weight for any of these shades. You can mix batches as needed and you get a consistent, repeatable result each time. I tried to stay closer to the original color scheme I had in the previous version, and I think it turned out even better this time.
If you're in the market for an all-in-one resin system, check out the UltraCraft Reflex. I will leave a link to it down in the description below. And thank you, Hagears, for sponsoring this video. Now let's get started on the assembly.
All the PCBs finally arrived, and I was eager to test the connectors. And of course, they didn't fit right away. When designing on screen, all the way zoomed in, it's easy to overlook some obvious details, like how these tight corners might be a little rounded, for example. Well, at least I can adjust them slowly by fouling until I get a nice friction fit.
Nice.
I got a stencil just for the core MacroPad PCB to try it out with the hot plate. However, I made sure to pick components with somewhat DIY-friendly sizes. I realized just now that I made this footprint a little too tight, and some rework was necessary to connect all the pads properly. Now, for the connectors, I glued the small shroud to the receiving part to hold the pogo pins in place temporarily before soldering the main board on each of the modules. Before starting the final assembly, I needed to lay and glue the magnets in place in the correct order before inserting the PCBs to hold them. So I made this little jig to make sure I don't mess up their polarities. You upload the Seesaw firmware to the 80 tiny chips on all the external modules. We will need a UPDI programmer. You can easily make one using a 1K resistor and a USB to serial cable. I'll put a link to more details on that below. That's it. I'm gonna call it done. And here's the final shots. Now that it's done, we can go over how the code is set up, and I can show you some mistakes and flaws that almost ruins the entire build. The main macro pad is still running KMK. I just wrote a custom module to account for whatever hardware configuration we have on the other side. This little arrow on the OLED screen is a visual indicator for the interrupt line on the connector. Whether it's first connection or an interaction on the modules, it shows up briefly on the screen. That way, if it stays for too long or it doesn't go away, we know that something went wrong or actively going wrong. For the analog devices, they're set up in a similar way, but instead of interrupts, they are pulled on an interval. They send MIDI control signals for provided MIDI nodes. That way we can attach that to special actions on the computer side. More info on this in the description below. It doesn't matter if you boot with or without the modules. As long as you have proper configuration, you will be able to attach later, swap position during runtime without problems. Which is cool and exactly what I set out to do, but there is a major flaw on the way the interrupt is handled right now. Remember when I said that a single interaction will trigger a scan for everything? Well, that turned out to be a horrible idea when you have a lot of them. What ends up happening is the transactions to scan each module start to stack up really quickly, and you end up missing sometimes the interactions because it takes you too long to get to the one that triggered it. With just one or two modules, it works really great and the delay isn't very noticeable. Also, the analog ones aren't really affected by this because they update state on an interval. I tried as a potential solution to encode the I2C address of each module and send it as a custom pulse to the controller on intra. That way it knows which of the modules is trying to talk and scan just that. It didn't really work great because it's still too slow to read in CircuitPython, and I'm still looking into it and how to make it run better. In the meantime, if you have any ideas, please let me know in the comment section. The other thing that didn't work really as I anticipated is the magnets. Unfortunately, they don't have enough force for this orientation. You can easily knock the module and disconnect it. On the other hand, if you have two of them or on the sides, they work really great and they have just enough force to keep them secured. If for some reason you still want to build this or just a part of it, please be aware of the issues and limitations I mentioned earlier before pouring your time into it. As per usual, I will leave all the files in the description down below, and so that you know, the build is structured in a modular way and you can build just the parts that interest you. You can make just a macro pad, for example, or just a detachable module if you're making a full keyboard and you want something like that, that will work great. I also want to warn you that the 3D printed parts in this project are finicky and very thin in few places. If you're planning on doing this in FDM, expect some post-processing to make the tight tolerances work and make them fit nicely. The UltraCraft Reflex from Heygears made it very easy for me to produce precise parts with great surface finish. And lastly, I just want to point out, even though it's pretty obvious, that I am not an expert in any of this. And what you're watching is me learning by doing and failing sometimes. Thank you so much for your time, and I will see you in the next one.